Okay, hi friends. We are going for the Yojana series, and this month Yojana is June 2021, Health and Environment. So in this Yojana, we are going to see two topics. The topic's title is Policy and Practices. Next title is Smart Agriculture. So for this month, we have only one video of Yojana because these two articles seems to be more relevant for our preparations. So we are going to focus on that. So the article is Policy and Practice, written by Dr. Subhash Sharma. Now, if you see the credential of that author, a retired IAS officer, so this immensely help our understanding the topic. So that is the reason why we always prefer to study Yojana and Gurukshetra. Mostly people with experience in that particular domain will be writing these topics. This topic will be more from administrative angle. So what are the aspects regarding health for all? So that's the topic, policy and practice, health for all. In that paragraph 1, page number 14, so this says about the historical perspective of health for all. UN envisaged a comprehensive integrated primary health care for all in Alma Ata Declaration in 1978 to promote equity and was driven by community needs. So in this, the most important thing about health for all is, so paragraph 1, health for all. There are two important criteria in that. One is equity based and community needs, based on community needs. So when you speak about health for all, this should be the basic character. So you need to understand the difference between equity and equality. In public services, the most important thing is equity. So understanding the historical disadvantages and providing the services, that's called equity. That should be the criteria for health for all. And community needs, what are the needs of the particular community, need to be taken into consideration. So understanding the different nature of the community's needs, and you are providing health for all. So where this, we can use this information as this criteria of equity and community needs. Any social needs of the people, right, can be health, education, or related to weaker sections. You can relate all these ideas, equity and community needs. And this is also historical perspective, that Alma Ata Declaration of 1978. In 1978 itself, the focus of health was taken into consideration. So that is in page number 14. Next, we go for page number 15. We can put paragraph 1, paragraph 2, paragraph 3, and paragraph 4 is there. Okay. So in paragraph 1, so regarding this World Development Report, had ranked common healthcare intervention according to the cost effectiveness. Its minimum health package for low-income countries considered to be about 1/3 of estimated disease burden and 1/5 of middle-income countries. So what we can understand based on this paragraph 1 is, this is given by World Bank. So World Development Report of 1993. We'll see some factual information and see how it is related to our exam perspective. So health intervention. So health intervention mostly in a society is taken care by the government. Example of health intervention, take example of primary health centers or insurance, all can be related with health interventions. Okay. So health interventions mostly focusing on cost effectiveness. Focusing on cost effectiveness. And another most important thing we need to relate is, especially countries like India, when we come for health, there's a term called out-of-pocket expenditure. What is out-of-pocket expenditure is, in our Indian society, a citizen spends his own money for health. That is called out-of-pocket expenditure. When public intervention is focusing on that to reduce this out-of-pocket expenditure, there is a huge impact on health of public health of the society. So here they have given the fact that its minimum health package for low-income countries considered to avert 1/3 of estimated disease burden. If public health is concentrated on low-income countries, so 1/3 disease burden, 1/3 disease burden is reduced, and that is around 1/5 for middle-income countries, that is 1/5 disease burden. So what we can understand from this factual information is, sorry, 1/5, just wait a minute. Okay, so 1/5 of disease burden is reduced. So what we can understand from this factual information is, as per this World Development Report of 1993, whenever there's a public intervention, government intervention in health, society's disease burden reduces a lot. That is, from in low-income countries around 1/3 and middle-income countries by 1/5. This you can use it as an introduction for answers whenever government public expenditure is on health or any schemes on health is being promoted by the government. This factual information gives a very objective reason why we need to have government expenditure on health. So that's, this is a factual information, you can use it for your answer writing. Whereas paragraph 2, structural adjustment or economic reforms during 1980s in poorest 37 countries, public spending on health per head declined by half due to cuts, in Mexico declining up to 60%. In Mexico declined 60%. So what happened is, especially in late 1980s, so we know that here we can relate with global events for understanding. So late 1980s and early 1990s, you know that Cold War was ending and the era of socialism was ending, especially communism. So a lot of changes happened in the society, government and the economy. That is called as structural adjustments. So the structural adjustments had a huge impact on public health. To give another example of structural adjustment is, we can take India's 1991, that is LPG era, where we moved from closed economy to open economy. That's a structural adjustment. And this structural adjustment have a huge impact on public health. That is, the data is being given. So where the public health cost is reduced by government. So as the failure of communism, soon a lot of countries got into big trouble. We can take India as an example. So that comes the structural changes, where we went and asked the money with World Bank and IMF. They asked to change the economy structure and they want to minimize the public expenditure. And government's public expenditure, first thing they touched upon is reducing the health expenditure and education expenditure. These are certain understanding based on a preparation we get. So that is the point what they say. In 1980s, when structural adjustment happened, public expenditure got the heavy beating and they have given some numbers for it. For example, in Mexico, around 60%. So example is Mexico, 60% public health expenditure was reduced. So you can understand what be the impact on the society, because government is not spending the money, especially in the developing countries where there is no great role of private players, and also people doesn't have the affordability to pay the money for health services provided by the private. So this has a huge impact. This is the information you can keep in mind. So any questions regarding LPG eras, challenges or critical aspects, you can give all these points. Okay. So they have given some points in paragraph 3. We just clubbed it. We can say take few points which is more for understanding purpose. What are the consequences? Because of the structural adjustment, what is the consequences or impact? So they have given first points. In states retired from development intervention, there was a massive decline in public investment in health sector like social subsidies, education, welfare of deprived sections. We already saw that after structural adjustment, government was reducing the expenditure and they are focusing on social infrastructure like health. That has an impact on public health. That is what given here. So ultimately what happens, there was a huge shortage of doctors supporting medical staff, leading to patients bound to go to private clinics. Because government is not spending money on public health, especially start with not creating any infrastructures and not recruiting people. So all this has an impact on the system. So that is given in paragraph, point 2. And also there was a shortage of medical equipments, drugs, pathological facilities in public health institutions. Reduced mere writing of prescription, patients were compelled to buy medicines from open markets. So this all we can see in our Indian system also, right? When we go for government hospitals, right now they provide medicines which we cannot buy it there because of shortages. We need to go for private place where they need to pay the money. And also when you say public health, it's not only about hospitals. There are all supporting services need to be provided. For example, there need to be lab. Example, if we need to have a blood collections, blood camps so that we can collect the samples and make a test. So all these labs need to be created. As public health expenditure is being reduced, government began to put a restriction on these type of allied aspects in health sectors. That is the point they given. And also another point, because of opening up of the market and all, private doctors began to put high, heavy fees on the health services. And also due to, fifth point, due to laxity of state regulatory apparatus, even government doctors supporting staff started giving more time at their private clinics. So there was no proper regulations after opening up of the market, structural adjustment, where government doctors also have a private practice after the duty hours. So there is a conflict of interest. So what they'll do is, in when the public health center, when a patient comes, means they ask to visit evening to their private clinics. All this was happening. So these are the things what they have listed out. And due to the retreat of state in providing subsidized food, sanitation facilities, there was rise in communicable, non-communicable diseases. Now please understand, health is not only about curative. So we'll see that it's health is not about curative, even preventive. So when you say preventive, means even before arising the diseases, we can prevent those diseases. It is possible by taking care of the environment of the people. What is that environment? Proper food, proper drinking water, good sanitation, public sanitation, all these need to be provided. As the expenditure of the government reduces on these areas, so disease burden of the people increase a lot. So that is given. So next, last, seventh point is more about a free market or invisible hand was based on the individual care considered as a private good, but in most of the developing countries there was no improvement quality of healthcare. Please understand, this concept of free market may be suitable for a developed economies where people are well aware of their rights, and also private players, there is a proper competition and proper regulation is existing. So that is maybe suitable for a developed economies, whereas in developing economy everything is nascent stage. So free market sometimes also results in bad outcomes. So that is what the points they have given for 7 points about structural adjustments. That is paragraph 3. Okay. Paragraph 3 is about consequence of structural adjustments. Mostly negative consequences is given here. Okay. And whereas in paragraph 4 they listed out, Cuba has sustained right to ensure cataract operation of all old people at public facilities. There's equitable health service delivery with regulation like 3 years of compulsory rural service for doctors and nurses, and radical shift in funding away from urban hospital primary health care across Thailand, Cuba. So these are some of the case studies which you can use it in your answer writing. So Cuba case study of doctors. Cuba's case studies of doctors. Rural service. So if you are a doctor in Cuba, it is compulsory for you as per government regulation, 3 years you need to spend in rural areas of Cuba providing health services. So this can be a point where you can use it as, you can use it in your answer writing regarding health in rural India. What can be done in rural India for improving health? One of the major problem is doctors are not ready to work in rural India because there is a different incentive structure in urban India when compared with rural India, because in urban India there are a lot of hospitals with modern technologies, so doctors can enhance their skill and knowledge about that particular medical practices, where rural India that's not a situation, so doctors are not going there apart from other personal reasons. So to avoid that, what in Cuba they have done is, it's a compulsory one if you are a doctor to go for 3 years in rural services. This you can use it in your answer writing for any questions regarding health in rural India based on this case study. You can say this as an example in your answer, saying that in Cuba they have done like this, we can also have the model in India. So that may be the reason we need to focus on this particular piece of information. And also they have shifted funding from urban hospitals to primary health centers. These are some factual information you can use it. Next thing is paragraph 2. So in paragraph 2, it's about National Health Policy 2017. So National Health Policy 2017 of India is given here. So what is the target is 2.5% of GDP on health expenditure. So that is the most important thing. That's a target given in National Health Policy. Whereas right now the current position is around 1.26% of GDP current. So whereas the target is 2.5, and 2.5% of GDP is an immense economic value which can be focused on public health expenditure. And one of the advantage of this expenditure is, as I already mentioned, that in India we have this out of pocket expenditure, especially in rural India in a family, if a breadwinner is facing some health issues, they need to spend all their savings on health. Again, that person need to be an employable person after this health issues are over. All these complications are there. Ultimately, that results making a family to put under poverty. If something goes wrong, the family goes under poverty. If that need to be avoided, if government is pumping in large money in health infrastructures and health services to the target of 2.5% of GDP, that reduces out-of-pocket expenditure, which has an impact on poverty, which reduces poverty in India. So there's a link in this aspect when government focusing on health expenditure. So national health policy, they have given a target of 2.5% of GDP. In that, they say that 70% will be on 70. Sorry, okay, I'll just go for here. In this, around 70% will be on primary health care. 70% will be on primary health care. So which we can relate with rural areas, very basic health services, primary health care, 70% expenditures will be focused. So in health services, there is terms like primary, secondary and tertiary. Tertiary is considered to be the most specialized health services. So a specialist doctors and all comes in this, or to be give a layman term, we have this term like multi-speciality hospitals. That's all not tertiary care, high-end treatments. Our government says that in this 2.5%, 70% will focus on primary health care, mostly who gets benefited out of this rural India. So that's in paragraph 2. Whereas in paragraph 3, this is a factual information which you can use it in your answer writing. So as per WHO standards, doctor to population ratio is 1 to 1000. So in any society, if there's 1000 people, there should be one doctor for 1000 people. That's WHO standards. Whereas India's ratio is 1 to 1,400, whereas rural India, it's very worst, 1 to 11,000. This information, you can use it in your answer writing. For example, doctors to population ratio. Doctors to population ratio, that is 1 to 1,000 as per WHO standards. That is 1 to 1,400 in India. It's all India average. So all India average is 1 to 1,400. But in rural India, it's very worst. So this factual information, you can use it in using your answer writing. Why in rural India, health is not properly taken care? One of the reasons is because of presence of doctor. So doctors is specialized services where they make all the decisions regarding health because they have the necessary qualification. If the doctors is not present there, ultimately that has an impact on health services. This factual information, you can use it in your answer writing. This once it becomes very subjective, because most of your friends, what they write as an answer is why rural India health is not good. They say that there is no lack of doctors. That will be written by everyone. But if you give this factual information, 1 to 11,000, that impresses the examiner very well. So keep that in mind, this factual information. And also another most important thing, why in rural India, that's given in paragraph 4. So why in rural India health is not good is, apart from this, most of the primary health centers and health centers are almost different in many North Indian states. Only ASHA workers, pharmacists, nurse sometimes visit there. Further, there is no facilities like bed medicine, pathological test labs. Nothing but, especially rural India, lack of doctor is one, and poor infrastructures. So poor infrastructure is another biggest problem in rural India's health infrastructure, especially North India. Again, you can relate this factual information, this information regarding uneven development in India and what are the reason why UP, Bihar development is very less. All this information, this cannot be the primary aspect of the answer, but you can support this point saying that that may be another aspects of poor development. Because once a person get health complications, if there is no proper treatment, already we see the cycle. One of the reasons is government's infrastructure is not properly taken care. So that is paragraph 4. Next thing is paragraph 5. East Asian region, okay, in India about 47% children are underweight. So this is another factual information. This is regarding malnourishment or malnutrition. Around 47% of children's. This is an alarming number. Please understand, out of 100 people in India, around 47, or not 100 people, around 100 children's in India, around 47 children's are considered to be malnourished. What is malnourishment? Without proper nutrients in their food, this has a huge impact on physical growth and cognitive skills. What is cognitive skills? Is ability to analyze the informations, make additions. Because of this lack of nutrient in their food, their metabolism and other factors will not be good, so they can't make any conscious decisions. So what is the impact of this particular information is, so any country's children is considered to be the future, because they are the future leaders, future workers, and they are future human resources. In that dimension, 47% of children are considered to be malnourished. This is the biggest area where government need to focus on. This information you can also write in your answers regarding focusing on children, policies on children. I think there was once a question regarding what are the provisions of national child policy. This information you can write it, probably the child policy will be addressing this problem. Okay. And next thing is, what is the outcome of this malnourishment? That is given in paragraph 6. So paragraph 5 and paragraph 6. Severe acute malnourishment increases with chronic poverty, lack of education, inadequate low nutrition diet, lack of clean water and sanitation. So when you take malnourishment, there is some aggravating factors. What is aggravating factor? Other factors also propel the malnourishment. They have given all these things like poverty, lack of education of mothers, lack of nutrient diet and lack of clean water and sanitation. All these factors increases malnourishment. And right now they have given some ranks of global hunger index, where India's rank is 102 out of 117. This fact changes every year. Please check that. This global hunger index, this can be a prelims question. Go and check which organization is releasing this global hunger index. Sorry. What are the criteria for it? How they measure this global hunger index? And similarly, we have a certain index like global food security index. Go and check all these indexes. What are the factors on which it is being decided and which organization is working on it? And what is India's rank? And also from, I'm saying all this from prelims perspective. Apart from this, you also need to go and check India's neighborhood ranks. Sometimes if UPSC want to ask a tough question, they can ask from comparative scale. So what is India's rank and what is Bangladesh rank? They can give a statement, Bangladesh is ahead of India and global hunger index. That you need to know it. So these informations you can relate in prelims angle. So right now that is in paragraph 6. Next we go for page numbers 17. So paragraph 1, that is environment for health. So if you want to improve health, what are the focus on that aspect is, first and foremost thing is Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. So right now government is focusing on Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. So it's more about clean India. We know that if there is a clean society, that has an impact on health also. So clean India is one, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, and balanced healthy diets and regular exercise. So this all is the aspect what government focusing on, diet and physical activity, where government is giving greater focus. To give an example of this, Fit India movement is one such example. Government is promoting this idea of Fit India movement. Okay. Next thing is to avoid substances. To avoid substances like alcohol, tobacco, drugs, all this part of this. And also avoid road accidents. Avoid road accidents. This is also part of this environment for health. Next thing is avoid gender violence. Avoid gender violence. Avoid gender violence and reducing stress. So reducing stress and reducing air pollution. And you will wonder how all this will be related to health. First few points seems to be very close to health, and how other things like avoiding road accident, avoiding gender violence, reducing stress. Please understand, these are all factors which has a huge impact on health. For example, avoiding road accident. Probably road accidents will happen in a family. If that is a breadwinner, that has a huge impact on the family's health. It's an indirect aspect. Similarly, if we take gender violence, especially women is considered to be the health managers of the family, because they take care of the family in the health dimensions. Because especially in rural India, I think in the previous Yojana we studied that women play a major role in collecting waters and the quality of water. That knowledge, traditional knowledge, women has a great aspect. And domestic violence against or any gender based violence will have biggest impact on health. These are all not directly you can relate it, just a common understanding we need to have. Reducing stress is regarding mental health, and air pollution which has impact on health aspect. So this is regarding paragraph 1. And paragraph 2, these are some case studies done in India, which you can use it for your answer writing. That is UP Government's Toilets Initiatives. Izzat Gar. So this is the toilet initiative in UP, and which has a positive impact on health. So that you can use it in your answer writing. And also, so there is some information is given for sustainable water management. The current economic system needs a paradigm shift, and water sources should not be privatized. So these are community resources for local people and their future generation, water for healthy life. So that is this opinion given by the author, saying that water is the most important resource. You should not privatize the water. It should be a community resource. So that point, if you are accepting, you can also use it in your answer writing. Water is a community resource. Water is a community resource. Not as commodity. Not as commodity. So next thing is paragraph 5. Paragraph 4. It's more about mental health. When you say health, means always keep in mind it's not only about diseases, it's also related to mental health. They have given some factual information. So in India, around 13%. Okay, they have given some numbers of mental health statistics, where 13% of mental health people need active intervention. So these are some factual informations given. So the most important information which we need to keep in mind is so 80% of people doesn't have health insurance, no health insurance. So this is the most important fact you can write into in your answer writing. No health insurance, and 28% of global suicides happen in India. So these are the factual informations. You can use it in your answer writing, and especially this suicide you can relate with mental health. And along with the other facts are more about mental health related facts. For example, 49% have mental health facility within 25 kilometers, and 26% of people have no mental health facility within 50 kilometer radius. These are the informations you can write in regarding mental health. These two information is general for health. So you can use these two informations. Most important, 80% have no health insurance, 28% of global suicides happens in India. Okay, so this is the first article, policy and practices. The next article what we are going to see is regarding smart agriculture. So agriculture is one important sector of Indian economy. When you say Indian economy, we can split into three sectors. One is agriculture, manufacturing and services. And basic facts about Indian agriculture you need to know. What are those basic facts? When you say agriculture, means basic facts. I'll just list out the areas where you need to work on the facts. One is GDP contribution, or what you call this GVA. So GDP contribution, what is this agriculture's contribution? And next thing is employment. Out of 100 Indians, how many are working in agriculture? Next, you can relate with rain-fed. There's a term called rain-fed agriculture. So what percentage of agriculture comes under rain-fed? So all this information you need to keep in mind. Even you can say about women participation, all this thing, you just work on the factual informations which you can write it in your answer writing. And this topic is smart agriculture. From the topic itself, we can have a clue that smart agriculture means more focusing more on technology based in agriculture. So that is what it is, the primary focus is. And here given the such values, correct? If you take, I'll just list out paragraph 1, paragraph 2, paragraph 3, paragraph 4, paragraph 5. So in paragraph 1, so agriculture and allied sectors. Allied sector means dairy and fisheries, all are related. 55% of Indian population's livelihood, so that is what I have said. So employment is around 55%. Out of 100 people, 55 people depend upon agriculture directly or indirectly, and accounted for 17% of GVA. So if you take GDP contribution, I wrote it as GDP, but you can put as GVA. It's around 17% or 18% of contribution. If 100 rupees is earned in India, 18 rupees comes from agriculture, But the irony is where 55% is involved in it. Out of 100 people working in India, 55 people are involved in agricultural activity, but their contribution to the economy is only 18%, which clearly shows that how our agriculture is very skewed, where productivity is very low. But by this, understanding these two facts, okay, that's in paragraph one, facts about agriculture. Whereas paragraph two, so the importance of agriculture is agriculture output is used as input for various industries, correct? Input for various industries. So what we can understand is the industrial economy of the country is closely linked with agriculture. So industrial economy is closely linked with agriculture. How to understand this is right now take example of sugar production, where agriculture output is required here. So these are good examples how agriculture and industries are closely linked, manufacturing activities are closely linked. One is example of sugar, what we saw. Similarly, jute results in packaging. So all this we can relate here. That's given in paragraph 2, show the importance of agriculture. And paragraph 3, some of the challenges in agriculture. The average size of farm holding in the country is just over 1 hectare. So farm holding in India is 1 hectare. So 1 hectare. And with small and marginal farmers holding around 85-86% of the total. So if you go for small and marginal farmers, holding 86% of our land, this is another fact. So what is the problem in this is, so these are the issues in Indian agriculture regarding land holding pattern. What is land holding pattern means? In Indian agriculture, if we take farm land holding, its average is 1 hectare. Out of all Indians, average is 1 hectare, which is very small. And in this also, small and marginal farmers holding is 86%. You need to go and find who are called as small farmers and marginal farmers as per Indian agricultural system. So ultimately, what the outcome is when the land holding is small, ultimately the decision making of the farmers changes. What decision making of the farmers changes? Because you have only 1 hectare, a small land holding, you never invest in technology, because investing in technology, getting the output, thus cost benefit analysis you equated, your cost will be more high when compared with the benefit. So you never focus on investing on new technologies. What is the outcome of this when you are not investing on new technologies? Indian agriculture will be a subsistence agriculture. What is this subsistence agriculture means? Where in agriculture practices, a farmer do agriculture, goes for his personal consumption, and if there is any extra, he goes for the market, to sell in the market. So these are the problems starting with small land holding. So that is what given here. So technology and other inputs would improve the efficiency, but they will not do it. Apart from this, a lot of intermediaries also there. So other problems in Indian agriculture is regarding, that is given here, that is middlemen. So middlemen is the other biggest problem in Indian agriculture, apart from credit issues. So credit is another biggest problem, that is money to farmers. So right now government is addressing all this problem. For middlemen, government is going for this ENAM, Electronic National Agriculture Market. So you can try to avoid the middlemen. So all these are some of the solutions given by the government. Where in paragraph 5, it's about technology and agriculture. So to improve the yield, efficiency and profitability, a lot of new technologies are being used in agriculture. So what are those technologies? One is IoT, Internet of Things, Big Data, Artificial Intelligence, Machine Learning, Drones, Sensors. So technology is being used in agriculture, especially to increase the efficiency, productivity and yield. So this topics, right, like IoT, Big Data, Artificial Intelligence, Machine Learning, Drones, Sensors. You do a basic understanding of all these terms, this can be a prelim science and technology question. Apart from this, you also need to work on how this will impact our agriculture. That is what we are going to see. That can be for your mains answer writing. So right now we go for page number 36, paragraph 1. So using predictive technologies to detect erratic weather, sensors to map the specific type of climate and soil and area, machine learning algorithm that determine the appropriate crop based on this data can substantially improve the quality and quantity of yield. In dairy and livestock vertical, the use of sensors to monitor the health and nutrition of cattle and drones to track herds can improve efficiency and traceability. So they have given the scope of these technologies in Indian agriculture. For example, if you take agriculture and technology, what are the scope is? So weather forecast, machine learning based cropping pattern, okay, sensors for monitoring animals. So these are the potential of technology in agriculture. So this can be effectively used by farmers to increase the yield and productivity in agriculture. So that is given in paragraph 1. And some of the notable, that is paragraph 2, some of the notable agri startups in this area of technology is they have given some examples like Fasal, Clover, Cropin, and Intolabs. So these are some of the examples right now in India where agri startups are using technology for improving agriculture. Whenever you get time, just go and check all these companies, what's their primary activity. Or to get in, given another way, just have a write-up of 4 to 5 lines about all these companies, what they are doing, in which area they are doing. So your answers will be more lively and more interesting to read. That's given in paragraph 2. And there's a box of central government initiatives and state government initiatives regarding use of technology in agriculture. One such thing is right now Soil Health Card mobile app is being developed using of GIS coordinates for registering the location of the sample and all those things. This information you can also use it in your answer writing. These are some of the initiatives of the Indian government and state government of using technology for agriculture. So that is given in page number 36. And if you go for page number 37, paragraph 2. So in paragraph 1 on page number 37, so they also give some important changes need to be used in technology based solution. Most important thing is localized informations. So localized information need to be considered in providing solutions. That is the most important thing. So they say that never give one size fits all solution. Localized recommendation which are sensitive to geographical, socio-cultural and demographic requirements. The fragmented and unorganized sector of the agriculture that involves multiple level of intermediaries, the hesitation of smallholders to undertake technology that would not be commercially viable and cost effective. So what are the challenges in agri-based technology and solutions? One is you need to focus on local information or localized information to be promoted, understanding the socio-cultural needs. Socio-cultural needs. That is one important aspect. And apart from this, adaptation. Especially if you go for farmers, they always love to maintain status quo. Status quo is a term which says that they doesn't want to change anything. So you need to convince the farmers to adopt new technologies. That is also the biggest challenge. So that is also given in the paragraph 2. That is the adoption and penetration of technology is a slow process that diminishes investors' interest. That is given. And lack of synergy between various advisors and their disconnect from on-ground situation also perpetuate low uptake of smart technologies. So another biggest problem is disconnect on the ground. So they give some recommendation where it seems to be not relevant to that particular issue. So that is called disconnect from the on-ground situations. So people not ready to go for smart technology. These are some of the challenges of smart agriculture. So these are the informations in these two articles. Okay. So right now we go for a question. So this is a previous year question. So saying this previous year question, it's related to health care. So right now you can see the display of the question. First we need to understand what is universal health coverage. So that is the question's primary focus. And the first part of the question says that public health system has limitations. Universal health coverage here means, if you say universal health means, it's not only about providing medicines and having hospitals. Apart from this, it is a very holistic one. What is this holistic one? Starting with drinking water, sanitation, nutritional diet, all is part of this universal health. And also the most important thing about universal health is it also has some key terms. So what are these key terms in universal health is? One is preventive, promotive, curative, and rehabilitative. These are the four dimensions of universal health. One is promotive health, creating awareness about health. And next thing is preventive. Make sure that diseases never rise, diseases never in the society. And curative, someone is having that particular diseases, we need to cure them. And rehabilitative, make sure that they are again taken into this society. These are the four dimensions of universal health also. Keep that in mind. So with this context, if you approach the question, it will be easy to answer the question. So I repeat again, universal health means it's not only about hospitals and medicines. It includes holistic aspect of health, right from drinking water to education to nutritional diet. That is one dimension. Apart from this, another dimension of universal health is one is promotive, preventive, curative, and rehabilitative. So these are the important elements you keep in mind. The first part of the question is public health system has limitation in providing universal health coverage. So how we can find the answer for this question is when you go for the article what we discuss about policy and practices, there are some informations which you can use it for your answers. What are the limitations of the government in public health? One, you can say the limitations of doctor presence, which we have some factual information, especially in rural India. And government expenditure on health is very less, and we can give the reason what will be the impact on public health, that you can say. And apart from this, there are some set of facts given here. And there are 7 points after structural adjustment, what happened in India, not happened in the global level regarding public health. Take example, shortage of doctors, shortage of institutions. So all this can be an answer for the first part of the question. So there are 3 parts of the question. The first part of the question, you just concentrate what are the limitations on the government in providing public health, where this information of this article can effectively be used to address the question. First paragraph, you need to say what is universal health so the examiner can easily understand that. Then you say about what are the limitations in public health in this universal health coverage. So why the government cannot be the sole provider of universal health. So that is one part of the answer. And second part is whether private sector can help this gap. Then you can say the answer, yes, private sector can play a major role in this. How private sector can play a major role? For example, they can leverage the technology in providing public health, like telemedicines. They can effectively use telemedicine to connect with rural India, and the most specialized doctors in hospitals can be using that to provide the diagnosis and procedures at the rural levels. So that can be done. And also when you take for other areas of universal health, for example, it can be insurance or it can be drinking water, nutritional diet, all this where the role of public health can be effectively enhanced. So role of private place can be effectively enhanced. So allowing private place insurance, that helps in improving health insurance in India. So this all the points you can say, and you can say that private place can play a major role in it. And third part of the question is any other viable alternatives. They are asking the suggestion with you. So what we can say is apart from this, we can also promote all alternative medicines which is accessible for the people, which can improve the public health. So right now we have the ministry for that, Ayush. So this was a question 2 or 3 years before. So ultimately you can see that what are the viable alternatives is like this preventive medicine, especially focusing on traditional medicines of India, that can be promoted. And mostly we can focus on creating awareness. That should be the more viable one. And this awareness can be done using technologies, like especially if you take urban India, where technology can be leveraged properly, like apps can be developed. So this is an area where they are asking about some solutions from you. So it's the most key word is viable alternative. You should not write your own imagination how to improve the public health, whether it can be implementable. So that should be the primary factor, correct? Like Ayush is one such thing. So promoting yoga is another one. So all this can be said as a complete answer. Okay, thank you.